Right now on Matter of Fact.
Farmers were very private people. They didn't talk about anything like this.
Family farms facing a financial and emotional crisis across the country.
He fought it hard, though. Yeah, give me a minute.
Now many ask, how much more can America's farmers endure? Plus,
what do you think will be the role of gay rights when it comes to the 2020 candidate?
And
court is adjourned.
Letting students decide how other students should be disciplined.
It gives us a sense of power, and it just shows like we have a voice.
I'm Soledad O'Brien. Welcome to Matter of Fact. June is Pride Month, a time to celebrate the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community and their struggle for equal rights. Organizers chose June as Pride Month to honor the 1969 Stonewall riots in New York City. They were a series of uprisings by the gay community against police raids of the Stonewall Inn, a popular gay bar in Greenwich Village. The riots are considered the start of the modern gay rights movement. President Trump marked Pride Month this year with a tweet celebrating LGBT rights, becoming the first Republican president to acknowledge Pride Month. But just a month earlier, his administration had effectively banned transgender people from serving in the military. Stacey Long Simmons is the director of advocacy and action at the National LGBTQ Task Force. It's so nice to have you with us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. Those two things are in complete contradiction. So assess for me. I mean, I think tweeting about Pride Month is kind of a low bar, but assess for me how you would say President Trump and the administration is doing when it comes to issues for LGBTQ people.
Well, first, let me just say, isn't it interesting that this president would be speaking out of both sides of his mouth in terms of what he would do on such an important symbolic day as Pride Month, and what he's actually doing in terms of policy, which is rolling back continually every single area of the progress that we have done under the previous administration.
I know you're being sarcastic, but some people might not read that sarcasm. Like clearly, he literally does that all the time.
Yes.
Says one thing, and in the actions, does completely the opposite, and in some very devastating ways.
That's absolutely correct. I mean, one of the early things that they did was in the Department of Education, removing the guidance that very much protected transgender youth in the schools and provided schools with clarity about how they should handle having transgender students in their schools.
Under Secretary Betsy DeVos.
That's correct.
The president has sought to remove questions about sexual identity from the 2020 census. What potentially could be the impact of that?
Sure. So the census is really important. And our organization has been leading on this since way, way back when, and was part of the early days when same-sex couples were actually able to identify themselves in the census. And so fast forward, we recognize that it's very circular to say that, well, we would support your community and give you money to focus on your needs, but we don't really know how many of you there are. And so now to say that we're not going to include you in the census is erecting a barrier, and it really keeps us from being able to have adequate representation, adequate access to resources, and adequate opportunities to really quantify our numbers and our specific and particular needs.
As a leader of the National LGBTQ Task Force, one could imagine that your job would be a very narrow focus of, like, this is what I do, LGBTQ issues, period, full stop. And I'm always amazed that it's not. You guys get into many, many other issues around criminal justice, around immigration, unions sometimes. Why have such a wide angle, if you will, on this?
Sure, because this country is actually representative of the LGBTQ community. So all of the issues that we're grappling with, whether it's parenting our children or having quality education or being able to have gainful employment, it's the reason why it's so essential to us that we are alongside all of our partners in the labor movement and in the reproductive health rights justice movement. It really has a very direct impact on our quality of life.
What do you think will be the role of gay rights when it comes to the 2020 candidates who are trying to speak to the American people? Will it be something that's ignored because people don't care, or do you think it's going to have a very big role in this now it's already started, so very, very long election cycle.
Well, I'm of two minds. I think that we are certainly past the point where candidates can go forward and not have specific ideas or not sort of cater to the LGBTQ community in any way. And so you'll find that many of them have actually courted our community specifically and directly. However, the culture wars that are underway, as I mentioned earlier, with regard to transgender people, are still one of the tactics that are used to divide and separate. So it's done racially, it's done along religious lines, it's done along sexual orientation and gender identity as well. And so I think that those candidates are going to have to be willing to pick up the baton and continue the work to get the Equality Act passed into law and also fix some of the damage that's been done under the current administration.
Stacey Long Simmons, it's so nice to have you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Next on Matter of Fact, the Dairyland in distress.
Thought he was doing better. What could have I done? What could have I said?
Farmers struggling with a mental and a financial crisis. Is help on the way? Plus, students leading the charge to change disciplinary policies in schools.
A new survey shows farmers are feeling less optimistic about the ag industry. The monthly survey from Purdue University found farmer sentiment has hit its lowest level in 2 years. Researchers say farmers remain worried about their financial futures as the trade war with China goes on, and now the risk of low yields because of recent flooding. Farmers aren't just facing a financial crisis, but a mental health one as well. Groups like Farm Aid and the Wisconsin Farm Center report significant increases in the number of farmers who are asking for psychological help. Our correspondent, Jess Gomez, shows us how one small farm town in Wisconsin is responding.
I've always loved the farm. We milked between 50 and 60 cows, raised our family, had lots of neighborhood parties, and people always like to come to our place, and so it's been a good life.
Winter slowly giving way to spring on the Stotts family farm in Loganville, Wisconsin. For Brenda Stotts, it's the first spring in 35 years without her husband.
You could just tell he was more uneasy, you know, with what things were going on.
Leon had a history of depression. It resurfaced last winter when the family sold its dairy cows.
To me, it's sad because this was what I lived.
But after years of low milk prices and rising costs of equipment and repairs, the numbers just didn't make sense anymore. Three generations of dairy farming came to an end.
This is ours, right here. Mm-hmm.
The couple, with help from their two sons, started transitioning to beef and grain farming. But Leon struggled with the change.
He didn't want to go places where normally he was very outgoing. He didn't like to have friends over anymore. Didn't seem to eat as much.
Despite months of treatment, Leon's third suicide attempt was successful.
It's like when you see your child struggling and they can't help themselves. That's what he was. He fought it hard, though. Yeah, give me a minute.
Leon's suicide rocking the small city of Loganville.
Most of the barns are deteriorated now, and each one of them had cows in them.
Leon's friend, Dale Meyer, had been taking him to treatment in Madison.
Thought he was doing better. What could have I done? What could have I said?
5 months later, Meyer is doing a lot, organizing monthly meetings for farm families in the basement of a local church.
So we staff crisis 24 hours a day, 365 days a year.
The idea? To connect farmers to nearby mental health care resources, financial help, and suicide prevention training.
If we can keep people alive and help them find options.
I struggle bad. I don't want to start crying again.
Conversations that were once only behind closed doors.
Farmers were very private people in a way you didn't, and as I grew up in earlier generations, they didn't talk about anything like this.
In the past, we have not talked. We're talking better now.
In Iowa, talking to farmers is what Dr. Mike Roseman does every day. He's one of only a handful of psychologists in the country specializing in agriculture.
We need to understand what motivates farmers and why do farmers have such a strong inclination to take out their failures on themselves, even though they can't control most of the factors that impact farming.
Roseman says the current economic strain, coupled with a lack of adequate mental health care in rural areas, is creating a crisis not seen since the 1980s. The scars of farm life no longer just physical.
I refuse to let my boy farm. I said it just was too hard on me, and I said, I don't want you to do it.
Yeah.
Do something else.
Roseman says what's happening in places like Loganville, a small town with a big heart, is a step in the right direction. For the Stotts family, there's comfort in knowing Leon's death could help save a life.
People have contacted me and they said they're so thankful because we don't know what to do.
As for the family's dairy barn, it hasn't been touched since the day the cows left, just in case the next generation picks up where Leon left off.
This is the family farm. It's Stott's family farm. And that's what Leon always said. It was never about just him. It's the family. And we just keep going.
In Loganville, Wisconsin, for Matter of Fact, I'm Jessica Gomez.
Republican Senator Joni Ernst of Iowa and Senator Tammy Baldwin, a Wisconsin Democrat, pushed for mental health provisions to be included in the 2018 Farm Bill, which passed in December. The bill allocated $50 million over 5 years for mental health resources, but local communities say much of that money has yet to make its way to rural farmers.
When we come back, giving students the chance to balance the scales of justice on their own terms. Plus,
one of Mother Nature's slowest and arguably the laziest creatures is now inspiration for a robot. Two million high school students are suspended or expelled each year in America. Black students are 3 to 4 times more likely than their white peers to be given an out-of-school suspension. Often the suspensions and expulsions are for minor infractions like dress code violations or tardiness. In an effort to address the racial disparities and take a more restorative approach to juvenile justice, many school districts are trying new methods of discipline, including peer courts. Our correspondent, Robin Hamilton, takes us to a school in Washington, D.C. that's testing a new law academy, where they're training students to hear actual cases from their fellow classmates.
When you're in high school, getting disciplined by an adult is bad enough. But what happens when the punishment comes from your peers?
Now, I'm going to explain the rules.
That could happen here at Dunbar High School in Washington, D.C. These students are participating in a peer mediation class, a half-credit course that teaches the mechanics of a court case.
The responsibility that was neglected was being respectful to others.
Today's mock trial has Larry Hyman defending his friend, Richard Bangura, over a fight with a female friend whom Zaria Boyd is representing.
So my student was on her way home yesterday when the defendant stopped my student and harassed her.
Shalina Warren teaches the class and brought the pilot program to Dunbar. Next year, she hopes to try real incidents from school where students decide the fate of their peers.
So a lot of times when you put them in the driver's seat and you allow them to see it from a certain point of view, then they see things differently.
Dunbar High has a rich, if not conflicted, history. Once the only school for African Americans in D.C. during segregation, it was seen as a place of high achievement. A century later, the school was dilapidated and had a student population marred by absenteeism, disciplinary problems, and overcrowding. A $20 million renovation in 2013 brought change on the outside, and administrators wanted that same change on the inside.
So we surveyed students to try to figure out, you know, like what's going on at Dunbar.
A lot of our students just want to be loved and they want a voice.
Dr. Mark Gomes is the school's assistant principal.
So instead of the principal or the assistant principal or the dean of students giving you a consequence, I think having your peers say, you know,
Mike, you were wrong today. These are your possible consequences. And it's not always like suspending a student.
The peer mediation class is inspired by a game called We the Jury, which is part of iCivics, an online learning platform that teaches civic engagement to students. Louise Dubay is the executive director.
iCivics is the legacy of Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, who really felt that civic education is something that is incredibly important to our country, that every student needs to be trained on how this system, our system of government, works.
When you talk to somebody about, oh, we're going to bring civics into class, you know that there are going to be students who say, ugh, civics, yeah. Boring.
The best way to engage young students, as young as fourth grade, is through games. Our goal is to reimagine civic education as something that students find fascinating and in which they can find themselves, that it's relevant to their lives.
According to iCivics, nearly 100,000 teachers across 50 states use the online platform. And the goal is to not only teach students civic engagement, but also to give them skills they can take beyond the classroom.
How can we, you know, work together to figure out, you know, okay, what's going on, why is this taking place, and let's meet at a norm so that when they take, you know, these skills out into the real world, it's going to help them become better citizens.
But what about the stigma that can come from one peer judging another? Since a real case has not been tried yet, the jury is still out on that one. Those students and teachers aren't worried.
Not at all. It gives us a sense of power, and it just shows like we have a voice.
And they know the students too. So a lot of that plays a part into how they mediate.
Giving students the chance to balance the scales of justice on their own terms.
Court is adjourned.
I'm Robin Hamilton for Matter of Fact.
According to a study from the U.S. Department of Justice and George Washington University, 99% of youth courts sentence their peers to community service. Other sentences included written apologies, tutoring, and jail tours.
Coming up next, the holiday proving good news doesn't always travel fast. Do you know the historical significance of June 19th?
Now to a weekly feature we like to call We're Paying Attention Even If You're Too Busy. This Wednesday is June 19th, or Juneteenth. It's the oldest known celebration commemorating the emancipation of the last remaining slaves. On that day in 1865, Major General Gordon Granger landed in Galveston, Texas, to announce the end of the Civil War and that all who were slaves were now free. This good news was bittersweet because 2.5 years earlier, President Abraham Lincoln had signed the Emancipation Proclamation. It is still not clear why there was a delay in getting the word to Texas. But despite the shock and confusion, an estimated 250,000 newly freed men, women, and children turned that day into a celebration. In 1980, Juneteenth became an official holiday in Texas. In other parts of the country, the holiday is sometimes called Emancipation Day or Freedom Day or Black Independence Day.
When we return, sloths are slow and sleep all day. But can their leisurely approach to life save the planet?
And finally, one of Mother Nature's slowest and arguably the laziest creatures, the sloth, is now inspiration for a robot. This is the Slothbot. Engineers at the Georgia Institute of Technology created the device. It's powered by 2 solar panels and equipped with 3D printed gearing to move from tree branch to tree branch, or for now, just a cable. The Slothbot mimics the real animal's sluggish movements, only moving when it must, with the goal of eventually measuring environmental changes in rainforests. Right now, the next step is to move the Slothbot to the tree canopy at the Atlanta Botanical Garden to see how it performs there. And then eventually, the engineers will create a body for the robot that looks just like a sloth and take it to meet its real counterparts in Costa Rica. Sloths, by the way, need to rest as much as 22 hours a day in the treetops. That's it for this edition of Matter of Fact. We'll see you back here next week.